I'm going to read the Daily Meditations by Omram Mikhail Ivanov for today, a very important reading. The relationship between the spirit and the body has, from the very beginning, been one of the questions that human beings have struggled to solve. So many so-called spiritualists consider the body to be, quote, the tomb of the spirit, end quote. They must learn to reason better. If the body were such a prison, if it were so opposed to human evolution, why would cosmic intelligence have sent them to incarnate on Earth? They should remain pure spirits on high. Yet, in those who neglect their physical body on the pretext of devoting themselves to the noble functions of the intellect, the soul, and the spirit, these very functions end up weakening and declining. In reality, the manifestation of the spirit in humans is prevented not so much by their physical body, yet rather by the fluidic shell made up of the desires, lusts, and conflicts of their lower nature. If we were not continually generating all sorts of miasmas and fumes, their body would become a perfect instrument for the spirit. I'd like to just reflect on this a little bit because I've done probably close to 1,000 soul-raising sessions in the last 3 years. And invariably, what will come up for some people is health issues. And in some cases, as they age, a decline in their physical capacity within their body temple. And the Holy Spirit is usually very gracious in how she, you know, communicates with people on how they can raise themselves up. In fact, it's a soul-raising session, so people are typically raised up in this beautiful radiance of divine love, and all of the aspects of it that the Holy Spirit perfumes them with. Yet I also see very clearly from the perspective of heaven that they kind of chuckle and almost turn aside their gaze from what they observe in terms of our habit patterns and what we do, which does not serve ourselves, which in effect, because of our physical habits, our dietary habits, our bodies are not operating in an optimal state. So what I've seen is that the choices that people make over a long period of time and how they live will impact especially how their end-of-life situation manifests. So if you desire to have in your kind of your waning years a body temple that doesn't have tremendous problems and pain and issues, don't blame God or think that you can somehow avert this by just spiritual force of will. Every choice you made on how to live, what your diet was like, whether you exercised or not, whether you drank enough water, whether you got enough sleep, all through the years, impacts exactly who you are now and how your body is operating. So I think we know this, and yet we feel that somehow, because the spirit's more powerful than the body, we can just kind of ignore all the inner sensations when our body's communicating with us, hey, either slow down or watch your diet, take care of yourself. You know, don't overeat, blah, 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 blah. And so I kind of have to bite my tongue when I see people who, by their choices, you know, if they smoked for 20, 30, 40 years, well, the effects on their lungs are going to eventually come back to haunt them. If they overate for 20, 30 years, don't expect that your heart is going to be functioning in its optimal state, or that your cells are going to be nourished properly. One of the greatest things we've had in the last 5 years is Anthony Williams' books and his recommendations, which are provided by a being who he calls compassion, who helps him to see clearly into the bodies of thousands and millions of people, and has inspired him and provided many teachings on how our bodies function, what is optimal for us with our diet, what we can avoid, and what we can do to get rid of toxins, etc. So if we are living consciously, now having heard this daily meditation of the Master Omram, we will treat our body as a temple of the living God. We will take care of it. We will love ourselves and nurture what is required. And that love must extend itself, and that reverence for who we are must extend itself more than just for a temporary fix or a week here or a week there. It must be kind of a new attitude, self-attitude toward appreciating ourselves, loving ourselves to the point where we honor who we are, this temple of the living God, and we take care of ourselves. So I will not make calls for people who want to be healed of all kinds of ailments later in life, especially, and demand that God somehow avert cosmic law and heal them of all of what is their physical problem, when it's obvious that they've abused themselves. You know, it doesn't sit well with me to do that. I will pray for their comforting. I will pray for their enlightenment. I will pray for their healing as much as the great law will allow. Yet I can't avert cosmic law, and God does not expect me or any of us to pray for some sort of instantaneous healing when the person has, you know, made all these choices for years and years and years. When they go into surgery, there's a reason for that. When they have to have intervention by doctors or whatever, there are many reasons for that. So I think we have to be real about our health and well-being, and we have to tend to the details of life where, you know, if we've had 5 cups of coffee for 30 years, well, our liver is going to be compromised. If we eat too much chocolate and sugar, our pancreas is going to be compromised. If we have done drugs in our youth, something in our mind may not be functioning at the optimal level. Now, everything can be healed with the violet light and through cleansing over time, yet it's not an instantaneous thing. And for some people who are very toxic physically, you can't just cleanse overnight. It is a gradual process where you have to maybe work with a dietitian or a nutritionist or a naturopath to gradually cleanse so that you're not immediately toxed out if you go on the Anthony Williams diet and start having celery juice every morning. And then all these toxins are released into your bloodstream, and then you feel horrible, you see. There has to be the understanding of the nature of what is transpiring inside of you so that you can do this as your body acclimatizes itself to the new diet. You know, so there's a few things that are very detrimental to our health. GMO foods, corn chips, soybeans, things like this, canola oil, so-called natural flavors, which we now have found out are actually MSG, monosodium glutamate, and even one of the things that we thought was vitamin C. What is it? Citric acid? Citric acid. You know, Anthony Williams tells us to avoid certain things, which then could result in things like Alzheimer's, dementia, and we never know. Another thing that came up in our life just in the last 3 days was I think I had laundry done, you know, in another place, and they use these dryer sheets, you know, that have the smell, and they are completely toxic. So please, heart friends, don't use those dryer sheets. What do they call them?
Dryer sheets,
yeah. With the fragrance that's just toxic. And please avoid things like that antimicrobial soap or the stuff that dries right away, because that is super toxic. And we could go on and on. I could name many, many things, but most of us are becoming more and more aware that we have to avoid things that have tremendous amounts of unnatural chemicals if we are to later in life not be beset by all kinds of aches and pains in our body. You know, we can avoid these things. Previous generations didn't have a lot of this, and they didn't have the dementia that we have today. You know, you ladies, you know, watch what you use when you color your hair, because if you're using stuff that's got ammonia in it, don't expect that your brain is going to function properly later in life, because all that stuff's going into your skull and impacting the brain. And I could go on and on. So I think we get the gist of this. I think we have to be real about our health and realize that every decision we make at some level of what we take into our body, both through our mouth and through our skin, impacts the totality of who we are. Now, does this mean that we live perfect lives? Because, you know, there's no way in this day and age probably to live an absolutely perfect life in terms of this, because we'd be fixated on it to the extent where it becomes so anal and so ridiculous that we give it too much energy. You know, so there's a balance here where we bless our food, we bless our bodies, we bless what we take in, and we use the violet flame, and that does the magic to kind of counteract the few toxins that unfortunately we are taking in. So we know about the violet flame, it's fantastic, and so we use it all the time, whenever possible, to kind of be that buffering and that divine, graceful energy that will mitigate as much as possible. Yet it can't mitigate everything to the extent that, you know, we mistreat our bodies. And God and our body elemental will inspire us where this is at, you know, at the crux of it. So other things to avoid if you desire your highest mindfulness: a lot of dairy, eggs, sugar, especially white sugar or any super refined sugar, gluten, all GMO foods, and heavy meats, and a lot of, you know, chemicals added to food, especially in restaurant food, over-salting, you know, canola oil, and all kinds of other oils. Again, you know, we can't avoid everything. When I travel, I do the best I can. I bring some foods on the plane with me, and I try to make right choices. But even I have trouble, you know, trying to live with a diet that is optimal for me when I travel. Yet if we all are conscious and we're all doing our best, then we just then let go and surrender and let God, you know, take care of us with the use of the violet flame, with enough liquids and rest, etc. So the reason I'm bringing this up is because I just observe over and over how people make their choices, and then they somehow feel that they're not responsible for the way their bodies are declining, or, you know, experiencing pain or problems, or they have sleep problems, they have, you know, terrible whatever, you know, going on in their body. So let us be initiates, which means we are responsible, we are accountable. We create our world, our life, by our choices. We can't get around them. Our choices are our choices. So now, having said all this, I think we need something joyous. So